It's a glorious day and you're here with a two guys and a dog special at the Henslite Vic Open. It's Damo here with our little buddy Chew Man, the always hungry Jack Russell who's never afraid to ask for an interview. Bringing you the hottest Henslite Vic Open action in Gippsland, creating a deeper connection between Gippslanders and the wider world, plus great feel-good music to inspire you. In the words of Audrey Hepburn, nothing is impossible. The word itself says, I'm possible. Before we get into some awesome interviews, let's get your blood pumping with Brave. In the words of Sarah Bareilles, you can be amazing.
You can be amazing, you can turn a phrase into a weapon or a drug. You can be the outcast, to be the backlash of somebody's lack of love.
Damo here from Two Guys and a Dog on 104.7 Gippsland FM, and I'm here at the Tarogan Bowling Club with Jim Whitehead, the events manager of Bowls Vic. G'day Jim, how are you?
Going all right, mate, yourself?
Yeah, fantastic, having a great time, and what a great event that you guys have brought down to here to Gippsland.
Yeah, it's amazing. Yesterday someone said it, they were driving up from Melbourne, said it's a piece of history happening today. We're launching the Vic Open in Gippsland. It's been in the Goulburn Valley region for past 12 years, so wrapped to have it down in the Gippsland area. We've got over 2,000 bowlers coming down and probably a heap more spectators as well. So ripper event, and we're really looking forward to it.
I love it. And what's your background? I mean, it sounds like you've got a bit of an accent there. Yeah. Where are you from?
Yeah, I'm from Birmingham in England. So I've been over here almost 16 years now, so a long time. So, yeah, grew up playing bowls in England, played since about the age of 6 or 7. So sports sort of been with me for a long time. And I've been now working in administration of bowls for probably 5 years across Bowls Australia and 2.5 years in this role at Bowls Victoria.
Wow. And so playing bowls at the age of 6, would you have been able to lift one of those things? Are heavy.
Yeah, they are. They are. We start off with the pretty small ones. No, it's good fun. It's good character building as well over in England. It's a big banter sort of thing. So you get pushed by some of the older blokes pretty early to lift your game and that sort of stuff. So yeah, it was a good learning curve for me for sure.
What was that like? I mean, how did you get involved? Did your dad play or granddad play, or how did you get involved?
Yeah, so my dad played. His older brother played over there. And yeah, it sort of just became a family thing. I'm the oldest of four, and all four of us played. One of my brothers still plays, the other two sort of moved on to other things. But I still throw them down every now and again. I'll probably bowl less now I'm working in the sport, just don't get the time really now. But yeah, I still play a few games of pennant and stuff here and there, so it's good.
Awesome. And what was that like? Because I mean, I relate to that. I played bowls when I was younger with my dad, and I found that was a great connection between myself and my dad. I mean, not every boy has that connection with their dad.
Yeah.
How did you feel that the bowls helped you connect with your dad and your siblings?
It was great. We used to play 3-4 times a week, so it's a lot of time to spend with family, brothers, sisters, my dad, my mum used to be the driver. She used to ferry us here, there and everywhere. So look, it's one of a kind of a sport where multi-generational can play. You'll look around this event in the next few days, you'll see heaps of husband, wives, son, father, son, mother, grandparent, granddaughter, grandson. So it's a sport that offers something that not a lot of other sports do.
Yeah, because I mean, that's what we really need a lot more of now, I think, with social media and that, and not dissing technology. I like my technology, but sometimes you feel it's a little bit impersonal, whereas from what sounds like what you're experiencing was a really close connection with your family.
Yeah, 100%. That's what it was. We spent almost, I mean, you would spend most evenings together as a family anyway, but we're not on the Xbox or PlayStation upstairs sort of thing. We're out playing, watching each other, supporting each other. So you get that sense of family and bond quite early. So that was great. And I attribute a lot of who I am as a person to growing up around the sport of bowls. So hopefully it's a good version of a human being, which I think I am. So,
but yeah, well, you seem pretty approachable, so which is great. But from that perspective, I mean, and I really liked that you went there and talked about that, because I said, from my experience, I had the same thing with my dad. I had this great connection where we were playing bowls. But not only that, I found that the other people that I was playing with as well were very supportive, very encouraging. Did you have that experience as well?
Yeah, 100%. Like, people used to, where my parents couldn't take us to a game or we were going too far away, they would step in and take us as well. So I have a memory of probably one of the best players in the region I played in. He used to play in the top side. I was in the second side as about a 12, 13-year-old. And we used to come back from an away game if they played at home, and he was there waiting for me with like a can of Coke ready to go, and he said, right, let's go play a game. So I'd play another game against him, but it took me probably 4 or 5 years to beat him or even get close to beating him. But just having someone who was, I used to look up to, was so good, just willing to take me on the green, teach me all the sort of tips and tricks he had to make him such a good player is phenomenal. And look, at something we see almost every day. We've got Matty Flapper playing in this competition. He's played over 400 games for Victoria. He's played for Australia. He's one of the superstars of the sport.
Yeah.
We ran a competition for a mixed pairs entry for a female to win a chance to play with him. So today he's playing with Dusty Taylor Irwin down at Newborough. She's 17 years of age and she gets this opportunity to play with a legend. So it's great.
Awesome.
You just don't get that in other sports, so it's good.
How do you think that helped your development as a young man, developing confidence to get out there and give things a go, having those people that encourage you? How do you think that helped?
I've never been short of confidence, to be honest. It's sort of one thing I was blessed with.
Well, playing bowls from when you were 6, of course. You know, you're going to develop that early.
Yeah. No, look, it probably developed my sense of humour more than it did anything else. Like, I'd sort of just grown up around not taking things too serious, not taking sport too serious, just enjoying it for what it is. And yes, being competitive and trying to win, but winning not being the be-all and end-all. And yeah, I kind of guess a combination of that and supporting a really bad soccer team in England. Like, just I got used to losing, using certain games. So,
do you want to mention the team?
Birmingham City. We're battling. We've been battling for a while. So we just sort of get that well-roundedness. Like, we... yes, you're playing to win, but you also recognise that you can't win all the time, and,
yeah.
and taking them losses, and yeah, that translates through to life pretty well. You can't win everything you go for, so yeah, just trying to remain pretty even and steady is sort of what that taught me.
Yeah, so from that perspective, do you found that those people were giving you that, like when you lose, it's okay, just get up and give it another go. Did that help develop as well?
Yeah, 100%. So the format of bowls I play in England was very singles heavy, as opposed to, it's kind of different here. We played singles games within a team. You'd add all your scores together for an overall win. So the games are quite quick. You're over in like an hour and a half. You'd play a game and then there'd be a game the very next day. So quite quickly, you could just move on from a very good win or a very good loss. So even having them good wins, you want to be grounded with them as well. You're not going to beat everyone to 21-0 or 21-1. So we tried to, it sort of did remain grounded. And that's the people around me did that as well. Like I grew up playing representative bowls, played for the county side under 18, but they never let you get too big for your boots sort of thing. So that was quite good. They build you up, but they make sure you don't go too ego with it as well.
Yeah, so you had a nice balance of building up the confidence, but also being respectful of that confidence, kind of like Spider-Man, great power, but
Pretty much that. It's pretty similar to that. Like, you don't want to over-celebrate. You do want to celebrate your wins, but you don't want to go too far with it because there's someone around the corner that's better than you or bigger and stronger, and they'll catch up with you eventually. So, it's a good rounding experience. It's a very good sport for that. And it's a game that involves a little bit of luck, some would say. So obviously you can't have the luck on your side all the time. So you are going to lose games. There's no way you can win every single game. So it's good in teaching that sort of stuff.
Awesome. And an area that I work in as well is I have a separate podcast where we're trying to find a framework for what is manly, because there's what young men out there and even older men that have kind of lost their way a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think playing bowls helped you? You know, because you're quite a confident guy. You seem like you're sure of who you are.
Mm-hmm.
How do you think bowls helped you develop that as well?
That's a good question. I think it sort of it allowed me to push boundaries a little bit, especially there's probably a little bit more wit and banter and humour in the game over in England. So it kind of let me push the boundaries there, but as I sort of mentioned, with winning and losing, there was always someone that was a little bit smarter than you or a little bit quicker. And obviously growing up young, you were around people that have been doing it for a lot longer than you. So I think it kind of just put me within a pecking order, just knowing that I was never going to be, I was never always number one. I might have a funny joke here and there, but someone was always going to come over the top of me and go somewhat better. So in terms of me finding myself, it kind of gave me that confidence to know that I could give and take that sort of style of humour. And I've got an 11-year-old and we have a fair bit of banter between us. I'm sort of raising him in that way. And one thing he always says is, never go, Dad, is what he says, because he always comes back and gets you worse. So it's kind of, he's instilling that on him. And I think it's a good framework to work by. You'd never get too big for your boots that way or too far ahead of yourself.
So as a dad, I'm a dad myself. Mm. I've got a 14-year-old.
Yeah.
And I find that, there's a connection there. And I'm trying to learn a lot from my own dad, which I had some great memories and time that we still do. He's still alive. So I shouldn't start talking. But from that side of things, how do you think, playing bowls and the relationships you developed and how you developed playing bowls helped you as a dad as well?
Yeah. Look, there were a lot of great men in my life growing up, but my dad included, and good role models. So I think growing up around that, you get a feeling for like what's right or wrong and where the line is sort of thing.
Yeah.
And I think that's sort of what I've learned from them. And I try and instill that with my little one, Lenny. He's a sports nut. Like, unfortunately, he doesn't really play bowls. He's sort of too soccer, cricket focused. And I don't want to take that away from him. Bowls will be there for the rest of his life sort of thing. So he pushes his own sports that he wants to pursue. So more than happy to push him in or let him go in the direction he wants to go in. So I think, just being around good men and people that show you the right way to sort of be a man in that way and be respectful to others. I mean, I grew up in a version of bowls that was fully open. There was no gender-specific requirements anywhere.
Yeah.
My sister, she's a few years younger than me, she was the first girl to represent the county when they made that open selection criteria as well. So, growing up in that environment helps you get a good respect for how you really should be as a human being.
Yeah, so it's a combination of not just, being a good male, but also respecting gender equality as well. Mm-hmm. Is that what you...
Yeah, 100%. And growing up, my sister was pushing boundaries back then as such, as a young girl playing the sport as well. And look, she was a very good sports girl across the other sports she played, soccer and that sort of stuff. So seeing her do that and grow in that, you have to have respect for that sort of stuff. I've never grown up with bowls being a male-dominated sport. It's always been very equal and open. So, yeah, that sets a bit of a good path for life, I think.
Yeah, I love that. And we got to move on to the product placement side of things and come back to Vic, to Vic Open.
Yeah.
Tell us about the Vic Open. What is it about? What is the aim of the Vic Open? What is it trying to do?
So just by its name, it's an open event, so anyone can enter. So at the moment, we've got a live streaming game happening down on Rink 6, which is a brother and sister who are from Traralgon. He's a pretty handy player, Damien, but his sister, Eilish, she's only playing her fifth game of bowls.
Oh, wow.
So she's brand new. She's entered just for some experience and some fun. And then on the other end of the court, mentioned earlier, we've got Maddie Flapper, who's represented Australia, represented Victoria. He's a legend status of the game. So I guess the aim of it is to bring everyone together for a celebration of bowls, and anyone can play against anyone, which is what we all want. We all want to experience new things as well. Like, that's why bringing it down to Gibson's been fantastic, because I would hedge my bets and say about 60% of the participants have probably never played down here before. It probably wasn't a destination for bowls as such, even though you got some fantastic facilities like Traralgon and Morwell. So for us, one of the big aims of bringing it down here was to expose this part of Victoria to the rest of Victoria in terms of its bowls clubs and the people down here, and what Gibson can offer as a whole outside of bowls as well.
So it sounds like the Vic Open is about bringing people together from a diverse range of experiences, backgrounds. Is that fair to say?
100%, yeah. It's literally just a celebration of bowls. So we've got participants coming over from America playing in this. We've got people from Queensland, New South Wales, some from South Australia as well. So it's the second biggest bowls event in the country. Pretty big prize pool to sort of bring people in as well. But I think essentially, if you look around this evening at 7 p.m, the games will finish about 5 p.m. So say 7 p.m. when everyone's gone home, showered and come back, you'll just see people mingling with one another. Like, and it's great to see. It's like, it's such a good sport for that, where people just, like, they would have played against each other, met each other the first time today, but there they are tonight, sharing a meal, sharing a drink, whatever. So, we're just happy to facilitate that and bring some amazing bowls. We've got 36 live stream games to bring in the next 10 days. So, just promoting the sport in that way, the modern side of things, live streaming on Facebook and YouTube and stuff. So, it's all positive for us.
I love that. And how do people find out more about the Vic Open? Is it just that this one time of the year, or do you have other events throughout the year?
So this one is it's shifted from November. We used to host it in the Goulburn Valley region in November time. We shifted it to March, which almost March, April, which crowns the end of the season, our regular pennant season in Victoria. It'll be once a year, so it'll be March, April each year, pretty much depending on when Easter falls. We've got 21 host clubs currently. We might extend that if entries go up in the coming years. So, it's always going to be March, April time in the year.
Awesome. And how do they get in contact with you? It's the website, thevicopen.org.au, I got it right?
I think it's .com.au, but it might be .org.au. You might be .org.au, you might know more than that. Our Facebook page, stay up to date with that sort of stuff as well. So we'll probably open entries for next year, hazard in a guess, like middle of the year, maybe August time. So they like our Facebook page, keep an eye on that sort of stuff, and we'll be able to they'll be able to know when entries are open, things like that. Our Facebook page is probably the best way to keep up with what's happening, as everything is with social media these days.
And I have to correct, I got it wrong. I just looked it up. It is vicopen.com.au. No. So yeah, so that's
I got a tick from Mallard Market Manager. That's good.
Exactly. You're not going to get fired this week.
It's good.
No, Jim, it's been such a pleasure having you on the Two Dogs special about the Vic Open. Thank you for making the time. It's been a great pleasure.
No stress. Look, thanks for helping us promote this event. We want to see as many non-bowlers down here watching as possible. We've tried to give the event a bit of a footprint in Gippsland. So yeah, get down to the local club and watch some pretty good action happening.
Awesome. And we look forward to supporting it at Gippsland FM each of the years going forward as well.
Perfect. Thanks, mate. Appreciate it.
This is Damo on Two Guys and a Dog, 104.7 Gippsland FM, bringing you the Henslite Vic Open special. And to keep things inspired and keep you pumped up, we've got Rachel Patton with her fight song.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion.
emotion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song. My power's turned up.
Starting right now.
I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes. Cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me. Losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried about me. In too deep, I say I'm in too deep.
In too deep.
And it's been 2 years, I miss my home. But there's a fire burning in my bones. I still believe, yeah, I still believe. And all those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I was screaming.
And you're back here at the Henslite Vic Open. We're at Traralgon Club and I'm with Chris Faulkner, who's the National Business Development Manager of Henslite. Now, you guys are the major sponsor of this event, isn't that right?
That is very true, yeah, and thanks for having me on to talk about it, yep.
Yeah, no, it's a great pleasure to have you on. From what I've seen, there's so much excitement happening around here. There was so much buzz leading up to it, and to have so many people connect from around Australia and around the world. You've got an entrance from around the world, is that right?
Yeah, that is true, yeah. I believe there's people playing there from America, from Tasmania, Queensland, yeah, so people have travelled a long way to come.
Yeah, so and from that experience of bowls, do you want to take us back a little bit? You might remember this. There's this very famous car. It was a silver car. It was a DeLorean. Doc Brown invented it. And when you jumped in it, hit 88 miles an hour, you could travel through time.
I do remember. Part of my childhood, yeah.
Exactly. Do you want to jump in that? Let's hit 88 miles an hour and take us back to your first experience in bowls. How did you get involved with bowls?
Okay, so like a lot of people who play bowls, I went to the local club, my mum and dad who played.
Yeah.
I had an uncle who played, my granddad played.
Yeah.
And then my sister started playing as well, who unfortunately didn't play in the end. But so I carried on. I got hooked. I played for the county. I've won titles in England, which I'm very proud of.
Yeah.
That's how most people get involved with the game. Just by going on to the clubs, they sort of, when the parents are having a drink in the bar,
yeah,
sort of running around on the green and throwing bowls around like a hooligan.
Yeah.
So then you sort of naturally take it a bit more serious as you get older.
Yeah.
That's how it works.
How old were you when you started playing?
I was roughly about 11.
11?
Yeah.
And this is the ironic thing I find, because I played bowls when I was young as well. And it's always seen as an old person sport, but that's not correct, is it? All the really good players are quite young. Is that fair to say? Very true.
You'll find that the grassroots of the game are probably of the older generation.
Mm.
But if you start looking at the world events like the Commonwealth Games, World Bowls, you've probably got an average age of maybe 30 of the top players in the world.
And that's not even close to midlife now.
No, it's not. So, yeah, it has changed quite a lot.
Yeah.
And from these events like the Vic Open, which we're very proud to sponsor, it's encouraging the young people to come and play.
Mm.
So, yeah, we encourage everyone to go to the club, take your kids along, have a look, and just get involved.
So how does, like, from your perspective, you started playing when you were 11. Did you continue to play all the way through, or did you have a break, or...?
Yep, so I carried on playing. I played a lot of other sports when I was young, like cricket and football. Well, soccer, sorry. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm learning that. I played all of the sports. And
you
I
haven't
gave
been
up.
Here long, have you?
No, I haven't. 15 months. And
oh,
I watched
really?
My first game of AFL last night, which was a lesson. So, yeah.
Yeah.
So I played a lot of other sports when I was younger, and I chose to stick with bowls rather than stick with cricket and the football.
Yeah. Don't talk about the cricket. There was a few years ago we would happily talk about. I'm not going to talk about it.
Yeah, it'll be a good summer, well, good English summer, I'm hoping. I enjoy playing all sports.
Yeah.
And I love playing bowls because it's competitive. I love the social side.
Yeah.
You know, I played with people when I was 11, 12 years old. I'm still very good friends with now.
Yeah.
And we've got friends all over the world now who played.
Yeah.
Half the reason we're here now is because we know so many people. who make us feel so welcome.
Yeah.
My wife bowls. She works for Bowls Australia. She's the high performance manager for the Power Bowls side.
Right. Okay.
So from that side of the game, it's very inclusive.
Yeah.
You know, anyone can play. It's a great sport, and I recommend it to anyone.
So how, from that perspective, you just mentioned, because you've been in Australia 15 months, if I heard that correctly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you said part of the reason coming here was through connections that you've made via bowls. Did I hear that correctly?
That is very true. Yeah. So I actually started working for Henslite by other people recommending my name to the bosses, which was obviously for me a personally great thing.
Yeah.
So, and it's been great. The last 15 months has been great. All our friends make us feel so welcome. You know, we've met people outside of the game and friends of friends. Mm. Yeah, they can't do enough for you. So, yeah, it's been great.
Well, it's a big thing to go from one country to another, particularly to come to the colony. You've come to the colony.
I know. Yeah, so
you've left the head monarchy, and you've come down to the colony.
That's right.
And that's a half a world away. Like, you're literally on. I'm not going to drill exactly through, but you're close enough to the other side of the planet.
Yeah,
that's a big commitment. But how is it that you made that commitment? With is it the quality of the friendships that said, okay, we can make that shift? Or
so it all sort of started from me sort of following my wife Ellen. Watch her play bowls around the world.
Yeah.
This is before we emigrated.
Mm.
I'd probably been here 5 times, maybe 6 times before.
Right, okay.
And every time we went back, we were always sort of thinking, wouldn't it be great to go over? But then Ellen was still playing high level for England, so it was a lot to give up on that side.
Yeah.
She got offered a job from Bowls Australia.
Yeah.
And we decided to just go for it, give it a go. Because we didn't want to get sort of to down the line when we were older and regret not making the decision.
Yeah.
Obviously, we're hoping it works out, but if it doesn't work out, then we know we've given it a good shot.
And it's interesting that you mentioned about that. Your wife was top level player.
Yeah.
I'm assuming she still is.
Yeah. You don't lose it.
Yeah, exactly. And so, from that perspective, when you look at bowls, and we're talking about, I mean, there's a lot in the world now about gender equality and creating more gender equality, which we should have.
Definitely.
I completely agree with
Absolutely.
That. And how do you feel bowls fits into that or supports that? I mean, because it sounds like your wife was, when we talk about this and you talk about relationships, your wife, sounds like she got the job offer here and you said, okay, honey, I'll go with you and support you. Is that?
That's pretty much how it works.
Yeah.
And, it's just, I just keep going back to it, but it's a great sport where anyone can play.
Yeah.
It's just amazing, really. And you meet friends and you just have such a good time in the sport. And you can take it as seriously as you want as well.
Yeah.
If you want to be competitive and go to the top level, you go for it.
Yeah.
But you can also just come along, you can play barefoot, you can just come for a drink and watch. There's so many sides to the sport.
Awesome. And what are some of your fondest memories in the sport? What when you think back about it, what are some moments that stand out and you go, oh, that really touched me or that changed me?
Okay, yeah. So I won 3 national titles in England.
Yes, wow.
Playing with good players, by the way. So I'll give them the credit rather than myself. but that, for me, in my personal game, that was amazing. There was something I never thought I would be able to do.
Yeah.
The names in the sport, people like Greg Harlow, Nicky Brett, were huge names in the bowls game.
Yeah.
I was privileged to play with them.
Wow.
So, and then from a watching point of view, watching my wife Ellen win 3 gold medals at Commonwealth Games.
Wow.
And a bronze. So yeah, I never thought I'd be involved in that and travel the world because of bowls. So it just shows you what possibilities there are out there just by being involved in the game.
How did that make...
Just a chance meeting of like me and Ellen, me playing against each other, turned into 20 years down the line.
You were playing? Were you playing together or against each other?
We played against each other.
Who won?
Yeah.
Who won that first game?
Well, in bowls terms, we were winning by 5 on the last end.
Yeah.
They were winning by 5 on the last end, and we got 6 to win by 1.
Oh wow!
So yeah, I just bring that up in conversation and every now and again, just to remind her.
Yeah. Yeah, I was going to say. She's got the 3 gold medals. So,
I know. So I have to have something to hang on to. Yeah.
But how did that conversation flow? After that, you've beaten her in bowls, and would you say, "Hey, I beat you"? How did you strike up that conversation?
I had bragging rights for a while, but then once she starts winning things, I'm sort of put down the pecking order. But it's funny.
But so you actually met playing bowls? That was the first time you met.
Yeah, first time.
Did you ask her out on a date straight after that?
It was a few days later, with help from joint friends.
Yeah.
So we say, So they sort of passed on numbers and things. So,
I love that.
And the rest is history, as they say.
That's awesome. And from that side of things, what if you were to look back at, the history? Obviously, you've got a deep connection with bowls because you've met your wife and
absolutely
playing bowls. What other things, if you were to look back at it, stood out for you that impacted your life and changed your life? Is there any particular things playing bowls that changed your life?
Yeah, I think...
apart from moving to Australia,
apart from that and getting married, apart from
let's
two
raise
small
the bar.
Things, that's right. I think it's a sport for me where when I started playing in good level competitions, for me it was a confidence thing.
Right.
So playing in front of people,
because
I was always a nervous type.
Yeah.
But it just brings so much confidence out of you, so then you can. It makes you realise what you can achieve.
Yeah.
For personally, that's a confidence thing.
And how do you find from that perspective? I know when I was playing bowls with my dad, I had so many mentors. It was people that would just give you advice, help you out, and be very supportive. How do you think that environment helped you with that confidence? Was that really critical, or was it? Do you think it impacted a lot?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I had a lot of people who I look up to, and still look up to now, who are still playing.
Wow.
So friends at home like who are great bowlers, and I feel sort of a privilege to be friends with them, really, and they encouraged me to carry on. Yeah, it's just, it all rolls into one, really.
And to put you on the spot, what was one of the funniest moments or one of the weirdest moments that you've experienced playing bowls?
Oh wow. Oh blimey. You have put me on the spot. I'm trying to think. There's been so many. There was probably funny moments, but I had a drink and I can't remember them.
fair enough. we'll leave that. If something pops in your head as we're talking, feel free to jump in with that. But now let's move on to your role at Henslite. Now, Henslite, before we get to that, actually, one question I want to ask, and this is a serious question. Are bowlers really biased? The bowlers will get that question.
I'd have to say, I like it. I like what you've done there. I'd have to say no. With a caveat of saying maybe some. Without naming names.
I love it. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to Henslite. We've got to do the product placement here.
Absolutely.
Now you've got the role at Henslite. Talk us a bit about what Henslite do, and I know they provide bowls, but give us a bit more experience about what their aim is with bowls as well.
Okay. Yep. So Henslite are a 100-year-old company.
Wow.
So there's a lot of history in the sport.
Mm.
They're one of the biggest, if not the biggest supplier of bowls equipment in the world.
Right, okay.
Including bowls, bowls equipment, bags, shoes, accessories. We do the club equipment, scoreboards, the mats, the jacks.
Yeah.
We've got sponsored players on the books, top-level players that we encourage, obviously, to help us out with social media and get other people playing bowls to promote our products.
Yes, okay.
So yeah, and for this event specifically, it gives us a chance as the main sponsor to come to the event with a pop-up shop, bring our products, showcase our new products, which we had bags which came in last week, for example, and just to take the products to the people. Obviously, it's an online world at the minute.
Yeah.
So by taking the product to the people so they can physically see it, it's a great opportunity for us to sell.
It sounds like the, I mean, similar drawing from the Apple model where you've got this really fancy, because I've seen the setup you got there. It's pretty fancy. It looks
yeah,
really
it looks good.
Kinda,
yeah. Big day yesterday setting up, but it was good. Yeah.
Yeah, you must have gone through it. I didn't think through that, but you must have gone through a bit of effort setting up because it's just pretty flash.
Yeah.
And people can also buy things online because that's where a lot of commerce happens now. But to have that physical presence there is, it seems to be, create that extra connection to people. Do you find that as well?
Yes, definitely. Absolutely. Yeah, 100%. Because it gives us opportunity to meet the people face to face. So buying online is obviously great in this new world.
Yeah.
But I think the whole face to face selling is still there in the market.
Definitely.
And the demographic who come to watch the Bowls Club and things, they're still used to seeing, touching and feeling products.
Yeah.
So, that's how we see it. It's a great opportunity for us.
And what about the technology behind the bowls? I mean, when you look at that, do you see in the future like little tracking devices in there as you're rolling them down or anything like that?
I was in England actually and someone suggested that who doesn't play bowls. So that you never know.
Yeah.
You could have like a remote control in your pocket maybe.
Exactly. Yeah.
Sometimes
change
I wish
the bias
I did.
A little bit. Yeah, I'm not so biased today, but tomorrow I will be.
Yeah, so you could see it wobbling down the green a bit. But yeah, like with the bowls, it's always moving forward. We've got new colours coming out. Like we released we call them duos. So the bowls are half and half, two different colours.
Cool.
So yesterday we released the Peacock Duo.
Oh, wow.
So if you jump onto henslite.com, you can see the products on the site.
Yeah.
And also we're doing a $50 off a set of bowls for the duration of the event.
Oh, okay.
Both online and at the event.
And so they can just come down and get that bonus there, or how do they do that online? So it's henslite.com.au or just .com?
So it's .com, sorry.
Yeah, just checking.
And if you go onto the website and see the advertising on the Vic Open, you'll be able to see the code.
Okay, and just grab the code, put it in, and get your discount.
That's it.
I love that.
Yeah.
Look, Chris, it's been so fantastic having you on the show. Really, really enjoyed it. Is there one last thing, I'm going to throw this one out to you as well. What's your, for someone wanting to play bowls, what's your nugget of wisdom that you would give them to say, if they're on the borderline, what would you say to say, hey, look, this is something to do?
I would just say, go for it. Just don't feel like pressured into going to the club because everyone's so welcoming. They'll do their best to help you out and play. If you go to a club there, 99 times out of 100 have equipment there for you. So you haven't got to worry about paying a lot of money out to start.
Yeah.
They'll give you trial bowls for a few weeks to try them. Hopefully Henslite ones, so then you'll go and buy Henslite in the end, obviously. It's just go for it, I would say. It's a great game to be involved with. A lot of people who pick the game up later on in their life, they often say, I wish I'd played this a long while ago.
Yeah.
So that's what I would say. So,
I love that. Chris, thank you very much for being on the show, Two Guys and a Dog.
No problem.
And we look forward to catching up with you in the future.
Thank you very much for having me.
You can never know what it's like. Your blood like winter freezes just like ice. And there's a cold and lonely light that shines from you. You wind up like the wreck you hide behind that mask. Look at me, I'm coming back again. I got a taste of love in a simple way. And if you need to know while I'm still standing, you just fade away. Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces. Made were meant to cut me down. And if my love was just a circus, you'd be a clown by now. No, I'm still standing better than I ever did.
This is Damo from Two Guys and a Dog on 104.7 Gippsland FM, and that was the ever-inspiring Elton John with I'm Still Standing. Hello again, it's Damo here from Two Guys and a Dog on 104.7 Gippsland FM, and we're still here at the Vic Open, and we've got Andrew Hoags here. Andrew is the General Manager of Commercial Operations for the Vic Open. Welcome, Andrew.
Hello, great to be here. Thank you very much for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure, and you've created such a wonderful event here. I mean, I've been running around looking at it, and people are so excited in the bowls, and you don't normally associate bowls with being excited, but I've seen so many smiles, so many people really excited. What was it from your perspective, you know, how do you feel about the event? What does it mean to you?
Oh, look, it's incredible. It's the first year the event has been here in Latrobe Valley. After 10 years being in Shepparton, we've signed a landmark agreement with Latrobe City Council, so we're here for the next 5 years. And just to be a part of that, and 21 venues across the whole region were being used now, 1,800 bowlers, their friends and family, bringing an incredible economic impact into the region, and it's just great to be a part of it.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic what you've done here. And I'm really excited for the next 5 years here in Gippsland, because it's such a wonderful event, and bowls is such a connection between people. Do you want to jump in? We've got the, you might remember this, I'm sure you will. There was a car, it's a very famous car, it's silver. Doc Brown invented it. It's a DeLorean. If you hit 88 miles an hour, if it's from Back to the Future, and if you hit 88 miles an hour, you can travel through time. So do you want to jump in that? We'll go back in time. When did you first get involved with bowls?
Well, I've been involved now for 2 years. As I said, you said from the outset, I'm the General Manager of Commercial Operations. Been in sport, working in sport myself for about 20 years,
yeah, wow.
Across different fields and different industries, from the AFL to cycling more recently, and as I said, the last 2 years now at bowls. And as I said earlier, it is really a strong sense of community and real social capital that is really involved in bowls events like these and like the Vic Open. And it's really important that coming off the back of COVID, that these sort of events are allowed to exist and be facilitated.
Yeah, that's wonderful, because what I've understand what I've seen out with the Vic Open is it's not, there's a broad range of competition that's here. You've got experts, and you know there's some people out there that I saw playing. It's like their fifth game of bowls, but they're playing with people that are highly experienced. To me, that seems like a real diversity that you're bringing together. You're bringing highly experienced people with beginners and supporting each other that way. Is that part of the intention behind the Vic Open?
Yes, indeed. I mean, there's $100,000 prize money up for grabs, and there's the elite chasing that, you know, with that prize pool clearly in their sights. And there's those that I spoke to somebody earlier, and it's her fifth game of bowls down there, and she's new and she loves the game and just wanted to come and experience that camaraderie, that social element that is so prevalent within events like these.
Yeah, it's wonderful from that, and from what I've found speaking to people is, and I connect with this as well, because I played bowls with my dad when I was little.
Fantastic.
And bowls is that kind of game. Not only is it one that spans the age group, so anyone can play against anyone, but also from a gender perspective as well. I mean, bowls is an equality sport when you look at it. And is that, how do you find that brings a lot more people together?
Yes, indeed. We see now the generations like yourself of picking up bowls. People are playing the game much sooner and being introduced to it, with Bowls Victoria looking after now just over 500 clubs, 40,000 members, many hundreds and tens of thousands more.
Wow.
Playing the game socially each and every week.
Amazing.
It's very much a growing sport.
Yeah, and from that perspective, I understand this event, it attracts, like, there's over 2,000 entrants, is that right?
That's right, just close to 2,000 entrants over the 7 different categories, and for the very first time ever, we're having the juniors, a mixed under-18s junior.
Oh, wow.
Competition,
yeah.
Which will be held again in the final at Morwell.
So that's a first for Gippsland. You've got under-18 juniors.
Yes, never before.
Yeah, let's go. We're going to rock.
Never before have we had that. So that's really exciting and great for the sport, yeah, to see the young juniors progress through the sport.
Yeah, fantastic. And from, I mean, coming back to my experience as well, when I said I was little, I was probably about, I was late primary school, early high school, I was playing bowls with my dad. And what I found, what was really interesting, was I had so many mentors, so many
gentlemen that were always supportive, always encouraging, wanting you to grow. And I felt my personal development benefited a lot from being in that environment. Is that something, I would imagine that Bowls Victoria encourages as well?
Yeah, and you get that sense of feeling going out from the clubs and events like this. There's a real sense of altruism amongst people and those that have been playing the game for a long period of time, a real connection and real sense of wanting to help the junior players progress and come through and learn as much as they can. And the sport's widely recognised for having that real openness and strong connection.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Mm. And there's also a number of supporting charities that connect as well. And I was told about the Bowls Great for Your Brain charity, where they get together, and what it is it's supported to help veterans that might have had some trauma to come out and connect with people that are playing bowls, and from that it's actually helped people with their mental health. From that perspective of Bowls Vic, I mean, is that something, again, when you look at it, when you look at bowls, it's a sport that really anyone can enjoy, but it also that camaraderie, the connection that we have, do you feel that that's a real benefit to society of people getting out playing bowls because it's good for your mental health?
Yeah, and that's really important to us too. At Bowls Victoria, we've got a long-standing partnership with PanCare to look after pancreatic cancer, and they'll be involved in this event to a certain extent again, as they did in the previous years at Shepparton, and it's really important for us to have that to be able to give back to the community.
Yeah.
There's a number of people and that have been affected by pancreatic cancer, so it was really important for us to align ourselves with such a strong charity.
Yeah, that's wonderful because, and you mentioned altruism before, which is really important because a lot of people don't realize that actually, even though your giving helps someone else, it actually helps yourself. By giving itself, you actually produce dopamine in your body and you feel good about yourself, which makes it has all these health benefits.
Mm.
And the fact that the bowls community has such an as you mentioned, has such an altruistic, maybe that's why bowls people live for a bit longer. Is that about right?
Well, it's great that people really want to give back and they have a real genuine interest in growing the sport. And no one really gets a chance to get above themselves in bowls.
Yeah.
And there's that real genuine interest in seeing people do the best they can do, growing the sport, bringing new members into it, whether that be young juniors at grassroots level or right through the ranks to the more professional side of things.
I love that. Mm. I love that. It's so important to give back, and it's wonderful in the community that we do have so many people in the bowls environment with that altruistic attitude and wanting to give back.
Yes.
Now, I have to ask this, and this is going to be a very, very serious question. He says, slightly tongue-in-cheek. Is it true? I heard a rumor, but is it true that bowlers are a little bit biased?
A little bit biased.
Sorry. A bit of play.
Yeah.
Okay. sorry, I had to throw that in there. But for the bowlers out there, for the people out there that are wanting to get involved in events like the Vic Open, how do they do that?
Look, I'd suggest they reach out to their local club. We've had a number of people I've been talking to this morning already, just expressing some interest that they're playing other sports, that came along and had a look today as a spectator. Reach out to your local club. More often than not, these clubs are offering free coaching and a great pathway to get involved. You don't have to be professional at the elite levels. You can be a lousy bowler like me and come along and have some fun on a Friday night, social bowls, and then get introduced to the sport that way. So lots and lots of different options. Numerous different programs to get involved in, and I'd certainly recommend it as a great sport, very social, and you certainly will get addicted to it.
Fantastic. Yeah. And now, because you just opened that door, so I'm going to have to go there. You mentioned being a lousy bowler. What's one of the most ridiculous... You're going to have to be self-deprecating here. What's one of the most ridiculous things that you've done on the bowls green?
Well, yeah, most of my staff, in fact, all of the staff at Bowls Victoria will tell you that I'm an absolutely lousy bowler. I don't trouble the scorers too often or challenge the elite, that's for sure. So, but it is a good game, and I can see how it is very addictive. You know, that one good bowl keeps you coming back.
Fantastic. Andrew, it's been such a pleasure having you on Two Guys and a Dog on Gippsland FM. Keep up the great work. We look forward to hearing about the Vic Open in the coming years and supporting that as we go forward.
Fantastic, Damien. Thanks. Great to meet you, and thank you so much for all your support. I guess I just lost my husband. I don't know where he went, so I'm gonna drink my mind.
You had the ever exciting and always popular Pink with So What? I'm Still a Rock Star. Hello, it's Damo here from Two Guys and a Dog, and we're back speaking with Chris from Henslite, and we're going to talk about the Bowls Great for Brains charity. Do you want to explain a little bit about that? What does that mean? I'm thinking zombies here, but I think I'm way off track. Do you want to?
Quite the opposite. So basically, Bowls Great for Brains is a up and coming charity that Henslite have partnered with.
Yeah.
In fact, the Henslite chairman, Ian Patterson, is on the board.
Yeah.
So it basically targets ex-servicemen.
Okay.
Who are suffering with mental health.
Right.
And it encourages them to get out, play bowls, socialise, and start to mix with people.
Yeah.
Just to give them some confidence to get out there.
Okay, so it's a focus on mental health and helping ex-servicemen that might have, you know, have a bit of trauma to get out and connect with people. Is that the aim of?
That's exactly what it is, yeah. I've met a few of the guys who have got amazing stories.
Yeah.
And
do you want to share a couple of those?
Or? Well, one of the guys, I won't name names obviously, but he said to me, bowls literally saved his life.
Yeah, wow.
Obviously in a bad place.
Yeah.
Got into bowls and yeah, saved his life, which is incredible really.
Wow. And so how do people find out about, you know, Bowls Great for Brains and how do they get involved?
Yeah, so Bowls Great for Brains are now spreading all around the country. Mm-hmm. They've got bases at clubs.
Yep.
Placed all around the country also, obviously. And you can go along to them clubs, meet the people. I think they hold monthly get-togethers.
Right, okay.
So you can just go along, be part of the team. Mm. No, you get a T-shirt, which is great design T-shirt.
Yeah.
With the Forces designs. And yeah, it's just brilliant. So you just Google Bowls Great for Brains or contact Henslite and we'll point you in the right direction.
Fantastic. Thanks for being on the show again, Chris, and sharing this wonderful charity of Bowls Great for Brains, not for zombies, great for the service people that might need a bit of help moving forward. And as you said, it has actually saved some people's lives.
Yeah, that's brilliant. Yeah, I appreciate your time also to promote it. We'll be right back.
This has been Damo on Two Guys and a Dog, 104.7 Gippsland FM, bringing you a Henslite Vic Open special. Chewy has been blown away by the inspiration and excitement shared with us. Continue to tune in to 104.7 Gippsland FM for more great, awesome fun and community connection here at the Henslite Vic Open.